In the 1750s, London was a city of vice. At night, its 700,000 souls thronged the streets and alleys. For the capital's pleasure seekers, money could buy whatever they desired. Drink, gambling, and sex were all on offer, and every taste was catered for.
Covent Garden is where one of the most sordid stories of the century unfolded. Its peculiar cast of characters included a pimp, an infamous lady of pleasure, and a desperate Irish hack. What bound the three of them together was a small book that held the particulars of every strumpet worth having in the surrounding streets. It's a story of lust, love, and the lost souls who survived through the dirtiest trade in the city.
Throughout the 18th century, the sex trade was one of London's most important industries. Alleyways and backrooms echoed with the groans of illicit pleasure. An army of more than 50,000 women indulged the libidinal whims of their eager clients. Everybody from street sweepers to the Prince of Wales revelled in the sexual carnival.
It's clear that a large proportion of 18th century men did visit prostitutes. You have to realise that most people married very late. Men would have met prostitutes in a whole range of different environments. In the first place, they would meet them on the streets, and certainly poorer prostitutes would be cruising up and down most of the major thoroughfares of London, actually tugging on people's sleeves, perhaps actually slipping their hand into their breeches in order to attract their attention or to start the process of negotiation.
At the time, Covent Garden was a seething mass of humanity. It was a place where two different worlds merged, London's main fruit and vegetable market and the fast-beating heart of the city's sex trade.
Every day, at 4 or 5 in the morning, whole groups of people from around London would be setting off, trying to get to Covent Garden for the beginning of the trading day. Beggars and street urchins, ballad singers and market stall keepers, as well as large numbers of vagrants and beggars who would sleep in the market square itself.
When the daylight faded and the street sellers had gone home, the market would be taken over by women selling themselves, not fruit and veg. And they would also be fairly noisy, fairly strident, brightly dressed, and fairly aggressive. Dr. Johnson was once accosted by one, and Boswell has him saying, "No, my dear, it won't do."
The streets were infested with raucous coffee houses and boisterous taverns. In almost every Covent Garden thoroughfare, there would also be brothels where men sought pleasure in the company of London's working girls.
The Rose Tavern, as depicted by Hogarth, was actually a very good example of what a debauched scene would have been like in reality in 18th century Covent Garden. There were rooms that could be rented out en masse and whores bought in, and orgies take place, along with wine, dining, and all sorts of sexual services were on offer. And so a gentleman could take his pick.
When hunting for female flesh, London's more discerning gentlemen would seek out one man, Jack Harris, the self-proclaimed pimp general of all England.
He was the son of a local tavern keeper and a shady figure, whose real name was John Harrison. Rather than plying his trade from the back streets as one might imagine, Harris worked from the Shakespeare's Head Tavern as a waiter pimp. Combining waiting tables and pimping was not uncommon, and Harris was by far the most accomplished practitioner in the city. The drunk and lascivious used to sate their appetites in the upstairs rooms, or go off into the night with a lady of their choosing after Harris had made the necessary introductions. It was this man who is the inspiration for the infamous catalogue of prostitutes, the Harris's List.
Miss Love, number 14 George Street. Eliza is of a dark complexion, being a downright mulatto, and intimates by the thickness of her hair and her eyebrows that she's well furred below. She charges little more than it is well worth, considering the scarcity of its complexion in this country.
At the height of his influence, the pimp general was said to be earning as much as the First Lord of the Treasury, and Harris was operating right under the noses of the authorities.
Both the Night Watch and the Bow Street Runners generally turned a blind eye to prostitution. They had to get on with the people on the street. It was not a question of arresting prostitutes because prostitution itself wasn't illegal. What they were interested in is maintaining an orderly city environment.
Harris built his carnal empire by ensuring he could offer his clients a steady supply of conscripts, ever on the prowl for new recruits to satisfy his customers' voracious appetites. He assembled a stable of around 400 women from all over London. Offering choice and diversity, Harris was able to profit from his clients' more exotic sexual demands.
Miss Robinson at the jelly shops. This lady is Jew, but has no objection to a bit of Christian flesh. But not in Shylock's way. She chooses her lover, and less than a pound will satisfy her.
Harris recorded the various erotic skills of his prostitutes, so when clients made their special requests, he would know immediately who to bring. Harris's notes came to the attention of another habitué of the local underworld, a dissolute Irish hack called Samuel Derrick.
Sam Derrick's face would have been a familiar one in Covent Garden. He worked in nearby Fleet Street, where he eked out a meagre existence and then drank and gambled most of it away. Not surprisingly, he was a very popular man and could count amongst his friends David Garrick and Dr. Johnson, in addition to a number of very friendly prostitutes. He spent the majority of his time either at the Bedford Coffee House or over at the Shakespeare's Head Tavern, where he watched with keen interest the movements of Jack Harris. Derrick was always crippled by debts, but by 1757, the bailiffs finally caught up with him. If he were to avoid prison, he needed a miracle.
Derrick had earned little from his journalistic endeavours, but he now saw a way to make real money by publishing his own guide to the prostitutes of London. Derrick realised that he needed to maintain some semblance of respectability, so he struck a deal with Jack Harris for the right to use his name in the title. This would give the book real credibility amongst London's libertines, and it would be much more than just a list of names and addresses. It offered intimate details of the prostitutes' lives and described their appearance and the services they offered. It would become the definitive record of the sexual peccadilloes of Georgian London.
Miss Loveborn, number 32 George Street. If we are not misinformed, this lady is one of the daughters of fortune, having a pretty good income left her by an old flagellant who she literally flogged out of the world.
Harris's list was wonderful for its display of the varieties of sexual predilection on offer, ranging from oral sex to flagellation. One of the most interesting was a lady who, such was the elasticity of her loins, that she could toss a man into the air and catch him again and put him back in the same place.
Like the prostitutes, Derrick also made lucrative use of his special talents. Overnight, the list transformed his fortunes. The advance he received for the edition of 1757 wiped out his debts, and it's estimated that within the year he'd sold around 8,000 copies. The lists were potent publicity for London's whores, but also for the more refined members of the sex industry, the courtesans. Charlotte Hayes was one of the finest ladies of the night on offer. She was born to Mrs. Elizabeth Ward, a brothel keeper, and raised at the very bosom of London's sex trade. Mrs. Ward groomed and educated her daughter, and eventually sold her virginity to the highest bidder. In a brutal era, there was no room for maternal sentimentality. Charlotte's mother wanted her to be placed in what was called high keeping. Under this arrangement, a prostitute would be handsomely rewarded if she agreed to become the exclusive property of one wealthy man.
Higher class courtesans would have lived a life of superb luxury, would have had the finest dresses, the finest silks, eat off silver plate and entertain nobles and live basically what would have been the life of an elite woman.
At the top end, there were incredible amounts of money to be earned. A high-class courtesan working for an aristocratic client, say, could earn perhaps £5 in the evening, which would be the equivalent of an annual salary for a female servant.
It was common for charming, well-mannered women to become mistresses, and many middle-ranking prostitutes wanted to make themselves the kept women of wealthy clients. To find the right man, the more discerning woman might cruise London's pleasure gardens, assembly rooms, or theatres.
The aristocratic woman was contained to her box, watching the play on the stage, whereas the prostitutes would have been circulating in the galleries overhead. But it was always rumoured that a prostitute could be identified through her makeup. And although aristocratic women did adorn their faces, if you wore rouge, it suggested that you'd lost the blush of your modesty. So it suggested you'd lost your virginity.
Miss Wilkins, she is not above 20 and has a very engaging countenance. She is a very good piece, and if you can forget she's hunchbacked, she is a little Venus.
Ensnaring a wealthy client was a distant dream for most of London's lower-grade prostitutes. Known as bunters and bulkmongers, many were half-starved and homeless women who sold their bodies simply to survive.
As you go down the social scale, most prostitutes working the streets of London would hope to earn perhaps 2 shillings, 2.5 shillings for a sexual act, which, in terms of what it can buy, is little more than what you would need to live on the streets for a day or two. And there are, you know, women, particularly in places like Charing Cross at this time, who will go behind a fence for a penny or two.
The careers of most prostitutes would be nasty, brutal, and short. The average streetwalker would be on the game for just 4 years. By the time they reached their mid-20s, most were considered well past their prime, though there were exceptions.
Mrs. Hamblin, number one naked boy court. The young lady in question is not above 56. We should not have introduced her here, but that on account of her long experience, we know that she must be particularly useful to elderly gentlemen.
But of course a woman could always fool her customer into thinking she was a fresh piece.
You may think that a virgin is a virgin, but no, a virgin could be a virgin several times over. And the way you did it was by a certain lotion which you painted in the obvious place, which at least produced the effect of virginity. Unfortunately, there was a small boy once in the kitchen of one of these houses, and he got hold of this lotion, and just out of curiosity, he painted his face with it, and the poor boy's mouth puckered up, and he couldn't open it for hours. Luckily, he eventually was rescued with some hot, greasy soup.
Other methods that prostitutes and bawds used to actually fake maidenheads, one of these was to either use a sponge or a piece of dried meat inserted into the vagina, which they'd hide in the bedhead. And a scene that denotes this is in Fanny Hill, where she actually hides it in the bedpost and then quickly whips it out and pretends she's this blood has suddenly appeared and she was a virgin.
By faking virginity, women could earn fast returns and a healthy profit. Such deceits were invaluable to part-time prostitutes, many of whom were unemployed actresses or domestic servants. It was not uncommon for lower middle-class girls, such as milliners and haberdashers, to supplement their incomes by offering sexual favours to men. In a world without welfare, where life was precarious, even prosperous families could suddenly fall on hard times. For an educated girl without a dowry, becoming a rich man's plaything was a way to secure a life of comfort.
Although it's easy to see the life of the kept mistress as one of glamour and
is the finest silks, eat off silver plate and entertain nobles and live basically what would have been the life of an elite woman.
At the top end, there were incredible amounts of money to be earned. A high-class courtesan working for an aristocratic client, say, could earn perhaps £5 in the evening, which would be the equivalent of an annual salary for a female servant.
It was common for charming, well-mannered women to become mistresses, and many middle-ranking prostitutes wanted to make themselves the kept women of wealthy clients. To find the right man, the more discerning woman might cruise London's pleasure gardens, assembly rooms, or theatres.
The aristocratic woman was contained to her box, watching the play on the stage, whereas the prostitutes would have been circulating in the galleries overhead. But it was always rumoured that a prostitute could be identified through her makeup. And although aristocratic women did adorn their faces, if you wore rouge, it suggested that you'd lost the blush of your modesty. So it suggested you'd lost your virginity.
Miss Wilkins, she is not above 20 and has a very engaging countenance. She's a very good piece, and if you can forget she's hunchbacked, she is a little Venus.
Ensnaring a wealthy client was a distant dream for most of London's lower-grade prostitutes. Known as bunters and bulkmongers, many were half-starved and homeless women who sold their bodies simply to survive.
As you go down the social scale, most prostitutes working the streets of London would hope to earn perhaps 2 shillings, 2.5 shillings for a sexual act, which in terms of what it can buy is little more than what you would need to live on the streets for a day or two. And there are, you know, women particularly in places like Charing Cross at this time who will go behind a fence for a penny or two.
The careers of most prostitutes would be nasty, brutal, and short. The average streetwalker would be on the game for just 4 years. By the time they reached their mid-20s, most were considered well past their prime, though there were exceptions.
Mrs. Hamblin, number one naked boy court. The young lady in question is not above 56. We should not have introduced her here, but that on account of her long experience, we know that she must be particularly useful to elderly gentlemen.
But of course a woman could always fool her customer into thinking she was a fresh piece.
You may think that a virgin is a virgin, but no, a virgin could be a virgin several times over. And the way you did it was by a certain lotion which you painted in the obvious place, which at least produced the effect of virginity. Unfoisy, fairly strident, brightly dressed, and fairly aggressive. Dr. Johnson was once accosted by one, and Boswell has him saying, "No, my dear, it won't do."
The streets were infested with raucous coffee houses and boisterous taverns. In almost every Covent Garden thoroughfare, there would also be brothels where men sought pleasure in the company of London's working girls.
The Rose Tavern, as depicted by Hogarth, was actually a very good example of what a debauched scene would have been like in reality in 18th century Covent Garden. There were rooms that could be rented out en masse and whores bought in, and orgies take place, along with wine, dining, and all sorts of sexual services were on offer. And so a gentleman could take his pick.
When hunting for female flesh, London's more discerning gentlemen would seek out one man, Jack Harris, the self-proclaimed pimp general of all England.
He was the son of a local tavern keeper and a shady figure, whose real name was John Harrison. Rather than plying his trade from the back streets as one might imagine, Harris worked from the Shakespeare's Head Tavern as a waiter pimp. Combining waiting tables and pimping was not uncommon, and Harris was by far the most accomplished practitioner in the city. The drunk and lascivious used to sate their appetites in the upstairs rooms, or go off into the night with a lady of their choosing after Harris had made the necessary introductions. It was this man who is the inspiration for the infamous catalogue of prostitutes, the Harris's List.
Miss Love, number 14 George Street. Eliza is of a dark complexion, being a downright mulatto, and intimates by the thickness of her hair and her eyebrows that she's well furred below. She charges little more than it is well worth, considering the scarcity of its complexion in this country.
At the height of his influence, the pimp general was said to be earning as much as the First Lord of the Treasury, and Harris was operating right under the noses of the authorities.
Both the Night Watch and the Bow Street Runners generally turned a blind eye to prostitution. They had to get on with the people on the street. It was not a question of arresting prostitutes because prostitution itself wasn't illegal. What they were interested in is maintaining an orderly city environment.
Harris built his carnal empire by ensuring he could offer his clients a steady supply of conscripts, ever on the prowl for new recruits to satisfy his customers' voracious...
Whereas the prostitutes would have been circulating in the galleries overhead. But it was always rumoured that a prostitute could be identified through her makeup. And although aristocratic women did adorn their faces, if you wore rouge, it suggested that you'd lost the blush of your modesty. So it suggested you'd lost your virginity.
Miss Wilkins. She is not above 20 and has a very engaging countenance. She's a very good piece, and if you can forget she's hunchbacked, she is a little Venus.
Ensnaring a wealthy client was a distant dream for most of London's lower-grade prostitutes. Known as bunters and bulkmongers, many were half-starved and homeless women who sold their bodies simply to survive.
As you go down the social scale, most prostitutes working the streets of London would hope to earn perhaps 2 shillings, 2.5 shillings for a sexual act, which in terms of what it can buy is little more than what you would need to live on the streets for a day or two. And there are, you know, women, particularly in places like Charing Cross at this time, who will go behind a fence for a penny or two.
The careers of most prostitutes would be nasty, brutal, and short. The average streetwalker would be on the game for just 4 years. By the time they reached their mid-20s, most were considered well past their prime, though there were exceptions.
Mrs. Hamblin, number one naked boy caught. The young lady in question is not above 56. We should not have introduced her here, but that on account of her long experience, we know that she must be particularly useful to elderly gentlemen.
But of course a woman could always fool her customer into thinking she was a fresh piece.
You may think that a virgin is a virgin, but no, a virgin could be a virgin several times over. And the way you did it was by a certain lotion which you painted in the obvious place, which at least produced the effect of virginity. Unfortunately, there was a small boy once in the kitchen of one of these houses, and he got hold of this lotion, and just out of curiosity, he painted his face with it, and the poor boy's mouth puckered up, and he couldn't open it for hours. Luckily, he eventually was rescued with some hot, greasy soup.
Other methods that prostitutes and boards used to actually fake maidenheads, one of these was to either use a sponge or a piece of dried meat inserted into the vagina, which they'd hide in the bedhead. And a scene that denotes this is in Fanny Hill, where she actually hides it in the bedpost and then quickly whips it out and pretends she's this head.
But it was always rumoured that a prostitute could be identified through her makeup. Although aristocratic women did adorn their faces, if you wore rouge, it suggested that you'd lost the blush of your modesty. So it suggested you'd lost your virginity.
Miss Wilkins. She is not above 20 and has a very engaging countenance. She is a very good piece, and if you can forget she's hunchbacked, she is a little Venus.
Ensnaring a wealthy client was a distant dream for most of London's lower-grade prostitutes. Known as bunters and bulkmongers, many were half-starved and homeless women who sold their bodies simply to survive.
As you go down the social scale, most prostitutes working the streets of London would hope to earn perhaps 2 shillings, 2.5 shillings for a sexual act, which, in terms of what it can buy, is little more than what you would need to live on the streets for a day or two. And there are, you know, women, particularly in places like Charing Cross at this time, who will go behind a fence for a penny or two.
The careers of most prostitutes would be nasty, brutal, and short. The average streetwalker would be on the game for just 4 years. By the time they reached their mid-20s, most were considered well past their prime, though there were exceptions.
Mrs. Hamblin, number one naked boy court. The young lady in question is not above 56. We should not have introduced her here, but that on account of her long experience, we know that she must be particularly useful to elderly gentlemen.
But of course a woman could always fool her customer into thinking she was a fresh piece.
You may think that a virgin is a virgin, but no, a virgin could be a virgin several times over. And the way you did it was by a certain lotion which you painted in the obvious place, which at least produced the effect of virginity. Unfortunately, there was a small boy once in the kitchen of one of these houses, and he got hold of this lotion, and just out of curiosity, he painted his face with it, and the poor boy's mouth puckered up, and he couldn't open it for hours. Luckily, he eventually was rescued with some hot, greasy soup.
Other methods that prostitutes and bawds used to actually fake maidenheads, one of these was to either use a sponge or a piece of dried meat inserted into the vagina, which they'd hide in the bedhead. And a scene that denotes this is in Fanny Hill, where she actually hides it in the bedpost and then quickly whips it out and pretends she's this blood has suddenly appeared and she was a virgin.